Hello, and thank you for being with me today. I'm Larry Wessels of Christian Answers, and we're continuing our study in the subject of Islam, this particular series on Islam. Now, we've done through this ministry many different series on Islam, on one aspect of it or another, but this particular one we're dealing with today is on answering Islamic apologists. Now, I have to explain this every time we introduce this show, but an apologist is not somebody that's apologizing for something. An apologist is just someone that is defending his position, particularly from a religious aspect, and showing why his religion is true, why there's evidences and facts that support his contention that his religion is true. And he also, at the same time, may attack other religions for being untrue in contrast to his religion, which he considers to be true. So an apologist, particularly in this case, an Islamic apologist, is someone who claims that their religion of Islam is true, and they say they have facts and evidence to support that contention, and they say things like the Bible are untrue or false or Christians are wrong. Because if the Christians in the Bible were true, well, then that would necessarily mean their religion, Islam, would have to be false. And the reason for that is, like, the Quran says that Jesus was not crucified, and of course the Bible says Jesus was crucified. So if the Bible's true, that would make the Quran false, because they say different things. So naturally, you get the logic, you get the flow of what I'm saying. And going in this respect, as we have in this series, all these hours of shows, this is show number 8 now, our main emphasis has been on Dr. Jamal Badawi's Islamic teachings tapes. This is from his Package 9, Series K, Jesus, Beloved Messenger of Allah, Part 2. And of course, Dr. Jamal Badawi is in this particular set that we're analyzing. Right here we see 16 audio cassettes, which represent his soundtracks to 16 television shows that he has done and broadcast to who knows how many thousands and thousands of people. And what we're doing is we're going tape by tape, trying to the best of our ability with the time we have available to answer the different arguments and claims that Dr. Badawi, coming from an Islamic perspective, says on these tapes. And like I said, the name of this series is Answering Islamic Apologists. And so we, as Christians here, are going to try to answer Dr. Badawi. And I'm with our Director of Research, Steve Morrison. Steve, great to have you here.
Thanks, Larry.
And I'll just put Dr. Badawi away. I'll put him back here where he'll be there for us for later. And what I'd like to bring up first here for your consideration is this point E, where it says, Paul assumed human nature was corrupt because of Adam's fallen sin. See, he doesn't believe in that fallen nature of man. See, if you assume that man has a fallen nature, that he's depraved in some way, and he's naturally bent towards sin. Like Jesus said, men love darkness rather than the light because their deeds are evil. And as you find throughout the scripture, such as Romans chapter 8, verse 7, where Paul said, the carnal mind is at enmity towards God. Of course, we already know that Dr. Badawi doesn't like Paul anyway. But
yeah, but hold on a second. In Muslim theology, they believe that that people were all touched by Satan, you know, in the womb. Jesus being an exception to that.
This is true. We brought that out on many of our other shows.
So does Badawi deny that doctrine, or does he say that man's nature was touched by Satan, as other Muslims do? You know, it's like denying this. It seems like he's going overboard.
Well,
denying
basically what
doctrine.
what he's saying is that under Islamic viewpoint, that man is not so bad like Paul's making out in Romans chapter 5, where he's got this fallen nature. And man, on his own merits and his own willpower, can do good works. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't need like this indwelling of the Holy Spirit to have the power to be born again and to turn to God in repentance. He looks at man as being someone who has he's not so fallen where he can't get things done on his own and achieve his own salvation. That's the way he's looking at it. And I'd like to turn our viewers to the screen here and take a look at some of this information I have dealing with this whole idea of the fallen nature of man in Islam and Christianity. Quote, then did Satan make them slip from the garden and get out of the state of felicity in which they had been. We said, get ye down, all ye people, with enmity among yourselves. On earth will be your dwelling place and your means of livelihood for a time. End quote. This coming from the Quran, Surah 2, verse 36. Quote, we said, get ye down to the earth, that is, you and your offspring still contained within you. Among yourselves means some of your offspring will harbor enmity for some others because of your oppression towards each other. End quote. This coming from the commentary of the Jalalain. I had enmity among each other, and there's some kind of trouble there that wasn't there before.
Yeah, so if Battery wants to say, well, the Bible is bad, that we have is bad because it has these people, you know, suffer and be guilty because of what Adam did, well, does Battery say the same about the Quran? He's knocking the Quran here.
Well, see, one thing that's interesting here in a lot of Battery's arguments and on his tapes, he's not mentioning the Quran that much. He does mention some, but especially on some of these attacks against Paul and things, he leaves a lot of that kind of information out, and you'd have to just know it to understand that. But anyway, let's go back to the screen here and see further information on this. Yes, God did accept his repentance and forgave him, according to the Quran, Surah 2, verse 37. But neither Adam nor his descendants were able to return to paradise, nor even to find it again. Since then, suffering, misery, and hostility have dominated man's life. Abdullah Yusuf Ali, a translator of the Quran into English, comments on this verse, quote, evidently, Adam is the type of all mankind, and the sexes go together in all spiritual matters, end quote. When God drew forth from children of Adam, from his loins, their descendants, and made them testify concerning themselves, saying, am I not your Lord, who cherishes and sustains you? They said, yea, we do testify, this lest you should say, on the day of judgment, of this we were never mindful, or lest you should say, our fathers before us may have taken false gods, but we are their descendants after them. Wilt thou then destroy us because of the deeds of men who were futile? This coming from the Quran, Surah 7, verses 172 to 173. Quote, he, God, drew forth each one of them from the loins of the other back to Adam, generation after generation, in the form they will take when they are born. They were so numerous, like the ants in Numan, a mountain, in the day of Arafah. He erected in front of them the evidences of his deity and installed in them brains and made them testify concerning themselves. End quote. This coming from the commentary of the Jalalain. Quote, remember that your God drew forth from the loins of the children of Adam their offspring in the same form they will take when they are born, century after century, and erected in front of them the evidences of his deity, and installed in their brains the capacity to make them recognize these evidences. Thus they were elevated to the level of those who were told, am I not your Lord? They said, yes. Thus their full knowledge of it, and their being deeply rooted in it, made them, so to speak, witnesses. Lest they say in the day of judgment, of this, that is, their knowledge of God, we were never mindful. Or they say, our fathers have taken false gods, thus we followed them. Wilt thou destroy us because of the deeds of the futile people? This coming from the commentary of Muhammad Farid Waghdi. Quote, the words of the text refer to the descendants of Adam, i.e., to all humanity, born or unborn, without any limit of time. Adam's seed carries on the existence of Adam and succeeds to his spiritual heritage. Humanity, as such, has a corporate aspect. End quote. This coming from the commentary of Abdullah Yusuf Ali. Quote, God took the pledge from the loins of Adam in Numan, i.e., Arafah. He drew forth all his posterity, which he created, and dispersed them in his presence like ants. He talked to them and said, Am I not your Lord? They said, Yea, we testify. Lest they say in the day of judgment, Of this, i.e., the knowledge of God, we were never mindful. End quote. This coming from the commentary of Ibn Abbas. Quote, In the beginning, when God cast Adam to earth, he sent him to a desert in the land of India. Then he rubbed his loins and drew forth every soul he decided to create until the day of judgment. That took place in Numan, which is behind Mount Arafah. God then talked to them and enabled them to speak. He took from them the pledge that they will worship him and never associate anything with him. He did that after he installed in them brains and granted for them their sustenance and determined the length of their lifespan, afflictions, and so forth. Then he replaced them in Adam's loins. Thus, the day of judgment will never come until everyone who gave his pledge is born. End quote. This coming from the commentary of Ibn Abbas. See also Al-Khazin 2, page 191. Quote, Thus Adam disobeyed, and his descendants disobeyed likewise. Adam forgot and ate from the tree. Likewise, his offspring also forgot. Adam sinned, and his posterity sinned too. End quote. This coming from Abu Huraira, quoting the Prophet Muhammad, quoted by Tirmidhi and others. Quote, We were told on the authority of Qais ibn Hafasa, on the authority of Muhammad, that God says to the one who suffers least among the people of hell, If you possess all the wealth of the world with which to redeem yourself, would you do that? He said, Yes. Then God said, I had asked something which is much easier than this while you were still in the loins of Adam, not to associate other gods with me, yet you have refused and worship false gods. End quote. This coming from the Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 3, 1213, number 3156. Quote, Whenever a soul is killed unjustly, the first son of Adam, Cain, would bear part of its blood, responsibility, because he was the first who decreed assassination. End quote. This reference coming from Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 3, 3157. See also numbers 6473 and 6890. Quote, On that account we ordained for the children of Israel that if anyone slew a person, unless it be for murder or spreading mischief in the land, it would be as if he slew the whole people. And if anyone saved a life, it would be as if he saved the life of the whole people. End quote. This coming from the Quran, Surah 5, verse 32. Quote, To kill or seek to kill an individual because he represents an ideal is to kill all who uphold the ideal. On the other hand, to save an individual life in the same circumstances is to save a whole community. End quote. This coming from A. Yusuf Ali, page 252, reference number 737. Fallen man cannot save himself, but he can be saved by Jesus Christ. Quote, He who knew no sin was made to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him, that being Jesus Christ. That reference coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 25. Quote, He himself, that being Jesus Christ, bore our sins in his own body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. End quote. 1 Peter 2, 24. Quote, And you know that he, Jesus Christ, appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. End quote. That coming from 1 John 3:5. Quote, without the shedding of blood, the blood of Jesus Christ, there is no forgiveness, end quote. Hebrews 9:22. Jesus said, quote, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again, end quote. Your reference there is John chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. Quote, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that being Jesus Christ, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. End quote. John 3:16. Quote, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his, that being God, according to his mercy, he saved us. Titus 3:5. Salvation is not by works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Now that was a long dissertation, and it went through a lot of Muslim sources, but I think it proves the point that you have, even in Islamic teachings, this passing on of the sin of Adam to his descendants. And there's even Muslim commentators that agree with that. We show you the references. We gave them to you. Read them for yourself. It was kind of a long discourse. I hurried through as fast as I can because of lack of time. But you can see that this very idea is in Islamic teachings. And it is clearly taught by the sacrifice of Christ for all humanity, because he is the second Adam, as 1 Corinthians 15 mentions. So what I want you to understand here is that when Badawi doesn't like this idea of the sin of Adam being passed on to all humanity, and he tries to attack that because he doesn't like that idea of the fallen nature of man, that we can pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps, what you can see from the Quran and from Islamic commentators and from the scriptures themselves that talk about saying, we can't do it. We have a fallen nature. We're evil and wicked. We want to do the wrong thing, and we need someone besides ourselves to bring us to God. We can't do it ourselves. We need someone to save us, basically, from ourselves and the wicked we do. And that's the blood of Jesus. That's the Son of God. We need him because we're fallen in Adam. We can't do it on ourselves. That's why we need Jesus Christ. And Jesus said himself, apart from me, you can do nothing. And another passage, Jesus was talking, and he says, they're asking how they can get with God, and Jesus basically says, with men it is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And that's the facts of the situation. So when you have these Muslim apologists running around saying, well, you know, Paul's an innovator and he made up this stuff, and we're not all that bad, and things of this nature, well, look what the Quran says. Look what the Bible says. Look what Jesus says. Special thanks to Dr. Samuel Shaheed for his research booklet entitled The Fallen Nature of Man in Islam and Christianity, from which most of the material in this section was taken. For more information, contact Christian Answers for Dr. Shaheed's books and videotapes done with this ministry. Now, let's go to the next tape here in this album, tape number 5. Here we go. It's Sin and Atonement, Crucifixion. A, Jesus is not purely sinless, Badawi says. Jesus is just like the other prophets. B, Badawi says exclusive language given in the Bible, particularly by John, examples from John 14:6, 1 and 2 John, is not fair or just because of various reasons, such as 1, what about those who never heard? 2, what about babies? And 3, those who lived before Jesus? And 4, other devout and sincere religious folks, etc. C, Badawi says divine truth is not subject to ifs and buts, but is imperative. If, of course, Badawi chooses to believe it. That was my addition. D, Badawi says, since Jesus prayed, he cannot be God, because this shows his inferiority, and Jesus' will was distinct from the Father's, meaning Jesus cannot be God, because if there are two divine wills, there must be two gods. E, Badawi references to the Gospel of Barnabas, which he says was discovered in Austria, which he says Jesus, in which it says Jesus was not crucified, but someone else was killed in his place. The Gospel of Barnabas says that the angels carried Jesus away before crucifixion, and Judas was crucified instead. F. Badawi dismisses messianic prophecies in the Old Testament as referring to Christ, his atonement, or crucifixion. He says the psalmist, in many cases, was praying to be delivered from a violent death, which is opposite from crucifixion. Badawi says God would have saved Jesus. G. Badawi cites Mark 15, Matthew 6, or Luke 23, John 14, Hebrews 2, 5, as mentioning Psalm 22. But Badawi says the New Testament writers were wrong here because Psalm 22 is talking about David and his trials with Saul and not a future event. Jesus not purely sinless, but like the other prophets? The Quran says that Jesus is sinless, and Badawi is trying to redefine the words. Many Muslims today would disagree with Badawi. They would say that Jesus is completely sinless, and Muhammad was also. See show number 2 in this video series entitled The Sinlessness of the Prophets of Islam for a thorough refutation of Badawi on this point. Those who never heard, Badawi needs to understand Romans chapter 4 verse 15 and Romans chapter 5 verse 12 that sin is not counted where there is no law. God judges everyone fairly, though we all have failed even by our own standards, Romans chapter 2. However, just as God could save Enoch, Abraham, and others through Jesus, yet prior to Jesus, God is powerful enough and wise enough to save through Jesus all who are destined for heaven, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 through 14. Babies who die. The Bible says that God is just and merciful. As for babies, the Bible in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verses 22 through 23 suggests that babies who die will go to heaven. We ultimately leave that judgment to God. Those who lived before Jesus? Does Badawi seriously think that either the New Testament or any Christian believes Abraham, Moses, David, and others are in hell because they lived before Jesus? The Bible makes it clear that all men of faith in the true God, not a false one, are saved by the blood of Christ, either before Christ came or after he came. See Isaiah chapter 53, Psalm 2 verses 11 through 12, Romans 8, 28 through 39, Romans 9, 5 through 23, Hebrews chapter 2 verses 16 and 17, etc. Other religious people? Devoutly religious people had Jesus crucified according to the Bible. Jesus himself said the devout Pharisees were going to die in their sins in John chapter 8 and Matthew chapter 23. God condemns false religion and those who sincerely practice it. See Deuteronomy chapter 13 verses 1 through 5, Ezekiel chapter 14 verse 10, Luke chapter 12 verses 47 through 48, John chapter 3 verse 36, John 14 6, John 15 5, Acts 4 12, Romans 1 18 through 32, to name a very few. Divine truth is imperative. Divine truth is imperative as long as it can be verified as divine truth. Badawi engages in declarations of what he calls truth, but sadly, he is lacking in empirical verification. The Quran and Islamic Hadith declare, quote, truth, end quote, but they, like Badawi, are sadly lacking in evidence to prove the veracity of their claims. Jesus prayed so he cannot be God. Badawi is repeating what he said previously on Package 8, Tape 8, Point I. Christian prayer is not like Muslim ritualistic prayer or recitation. Biblical prayer is relational communication in the same sense as loving family members communicate with each other. Badawi is hampered in his understanding of Christian prayer by his Muslim cultural upbringing. Jesus and God the Father, thus, are not restricted by Badawi's limited understanding of prayer. Therefore, Badawi's argument is flawed and pointless. Badawi's attachment to the Gospel of Barnabas. Badawi must really like this forgery, as he is repeating what he said previously in Package 8, Tape 3, Point D. After Muhammad's time, many Muslims created hundreds of thousands of fake hadiths about Muhammad, including that Muhammad said Ali was burning in hell. The Gospel of Barnabas would fall into the category of a fake hadith or even a fake surah. Interestingly, the Gospel of Barnabas denies teachings found in both the Quran and the Bible. Contact us for more information on this subject. Badawi claims messianic prophecies cannot refer to Jesus because God would have saved Jesus. Most Muslims believe without question what the Quran states, that Jesus is the Messiah. Yet Badawi wants to downplay that Jesus is the Messiah. This is most interesting, as the Gospel of Barnabas contradicts the Quran in saying Jesus was not the Messiah. Muhammad was. Actually, there is not a single surah in the Quran or hadith in the Al-Bukhari or Sahih Muslim where Muhammad claimed to be the Messiah. Badawi claims messianic prophecies cannot refer to Jesus. As usual, Badawi is totally wrong. The New Testament writers use hundreds of Old Testament prophecies about the coming Messiah to prove their case that Jesus is the Messiah. Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27 gives the exact time frame for the arrival of the Messiah. Isaiah 53, 1 through 12, the Messiah suffers for transgressions of the people. Micah chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, Messiah to be born in Bethlehem. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, and chapter 9, verse 6, the mighty God to be born to a virgin. Zechariah chapter 11, verses 12 through 13, Messiah sold for 30 pieces of silver. Isaiah chapter 29, verses 18 through 19, Messiah to make the deaf hear and the blind see. Psalm 2, verses 11 and 12, Messiah is the Son of God and must be trusted for salvation. Ezekiel 34, 23 and 24, Messiah is the Good Shepherd. See John 10, 11. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 22, Messiah conceived by the Holy Spirit. See Matthew 1, verse 20, Luke chapter 1, verse 35. Psalm 78, verse 2, Messiah speaks in parables. See Matthew chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 10, Messiah has triumphal entry on the foal of a donkey. See Matthew chapter 21, verses 4 and 5, Mark chapter 11, verses 9 and 10, and Luke chapter 20, verse 38, John chapter 12, verses 13 through 15. Daniel chapter 7, verses 9 through 14, Messiah is the Ancient of Days and is known as the Son of Man, who is given everlasting dominion and glory, and a kingdom that all people and nations should serve him forever. See Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 and 32, Matthew 26, verses 62 and following, Mark chapter 14, verses 61 through 65, Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, Revelation chapter 5, verse 11, and many, many more. Psalm 22, 1 through 18, Messiah will be crucified and mocked. See Matthew chapter 27, verses 25 through 54, Mark 15, 34, Luke 23, 35, John 19, verse 18 and following, John chapter 20, verse 25, 27, etc. Psalm 22 only speaks of David's trials with Saul. It is plain by the previous messianic prophecies cited, of which over 400 exist, Badawi has intentionally refused to see the obvious nature of this situation. Badawi, instead of believing what the New Testament writers are saying, blindly attempts to grasp straws to say that the gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are all liars without a convincing argument. Like the old saying goes, quote, there are none so blind as those who refuse to see, end quote.
There's all kinds of books at your Christian bookstore dealing with Bible prophecies. And Badawi just doesn't want to believe them. He doesn't like them, and his arguments attacking them just don't work. He simply says, take my word for it rather than these Bible writers.
And I invite our viewers to get these books, such as Josh McDowell's Evidence That Demands a Verdict and other books that deal with Bible prophecy. There's a lot of great material there, and there's thousands of Bible prophecies fulfilled. These prophecies make Nostradamus, these other guys, look like, just worthless bums on the street. We're going to tape number 6 in this particular album I just showed you, which is entitled Crucifixion Parts 2 and 3. Point A, Badawi says, New Testament writers were obsessed with prophecy, end quote. B, Badawi says the New Testament writers constantly misquoted Old Testament passages to support their unfounded claims about crucifixion and Jesus being God. Badawi quotes Psalm 9, Psalm 109, and Psalm 21 to say a, quote, servant of God, end quote, would be delivered and not crucified, but the wicked would get the curse. And he quotes Deuteronomy 21:23, and that would be Judas being crucified and not Jesus. C, Badawi says Jesus was well loved by lots of people, so Psalm 69:21 could not be a prophecy about him because of verse 4. Badawi also talks about the sins of the person mentioned in Psalm 69, so John was wrong in John 19:28-29 in referring to Jesus here in Psalm 69, as Badawi would say. Badawi says Psalm 69 is more about Judas than Jesus, so he's basically saying that Christians have it wrong, the writers of the Gospels have it wrong. They mixed up this prophecy in Psalm 69 and thought it was talking about Jesus when really it was talking about Judas. Okay, and point D, Badawi says Matthew makes a mistake in facts in Matthew 27 verses 3 through 10 by quoting Jeremiah when he was actually quoting Zechariah chapter 11 verses 12 and 13. And therefore, Matthew's gospel has mistakes and cannot be trusted. Obsessed with prophecy? By using the term obsessed, Badawi unintentionally reveals the importance, relevance, and frequency of biblical prophecy referred to by New Testament writers. The biblical writers understood the magnitude and the supernatural power of God in fulfilled Bible prophecy, and therefore they referred to it constantly. Fulfilled Bible prophecy was a major evidence used by New Testament writers to prove that Jesus was the Messiah, and the gospel of Christ, as found in Scripture, was ordained by the Almighty God. Jesus himself appealed to messianic prophecy constantly. Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. Matthew 5:17. And beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in the Scriptures. Luke chapter 24, verse 27. Now he said to them, These are my words, which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things that are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Luke chapter 24, verse 44. But all this has taken place that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled. Matthew 26:56. See also John 5:39, verse 40, verse 46, verse 47, Matthew 13:14, Matthew 21:42, Mark 13:26, Luke 4, verses 20 and 21, Luke 22, verse 37, John 15:25, etc. The New Testament writers appealed to messianic prophecy constantly. But the things which God announced beforehand by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ should suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Acts 3:18. Of him all the prophets bear witness, that through his name, everyone who believes in him, that's Jesus Christ, has received forgiveness of sins. Acts 10:43. And when they had carried out all that was written concerning him, that's Jesus Christ, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb, Acts 13:29, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, Romans 1, verse 2. See also Acts chapter 17, verses 2 and 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 and 6, Matthew chapter 2, verses 4 through 6, etc. The day Jesus died on the cross was the day in which the Lord fulfilled 33 Old Testament prophecies which had been written hundreds of years in advance of this event. Here are just a few. Prophecy and its fulfillment. First, Genesis 3:15, fulfilled in John 19:18. Exodus chapter 12, verse 46, fulfilled in John 19:36. Psalm 2:2, fulfilled in Mark 15:1. Prophecy, Psalm 22, verses 6 through 8, fulfilled in Matthew 27, verses 39 through 44. Psalm 31:5, fulfilled in Luke 23:46. Psalm 38:11, fulfilled in Luke 23:49. Psalm 41:9, fulfilled in John 13:18. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 7, fulfilled in Matthew 26, verses 62 through 63. Isaiah 61:8, fulfilled in Mark 14:24. Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, fulfilled in Matthew 26:24. Zechariah 13:7, fulfilled in Mark chapter 14, verses 27 and verse 50. It is Badawi who is obsessed with prophecy in the sense that he twists prophecy to say what he wants it to say. For example, Badawi is obsessed with Old Testament prophecies talking about Judas rather than Jesus. But the Lord Jesus Christ would disagree. Jesus said, quote, "Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me," end quote. Is all of this just coincidence? Were these tax collectors and fishermen who wrote down the New Testament so informed on Old Testament messianic prophecies that they could successfully write stories about a Messiah who some claim never existed in the first place, yet convert thousands of Jews who lived at the same time as the supposed Messiah? In fact, convert Jews with sound historical tradition without any real evidence at all, without any tangible evidence that this Jesus even existed or did miracles? Of course, Badawi ignores this. Psalm 9, 109 and 21 referred to Judas. Psalm 9, 109 and 21 are not generally given by Christians as proof that Jesus was prophesied in the Old Testament. Badawi selectively chooses what could be called less strong prophetic passages in comparison to very strong and clear ones, such as Isaiah chapter 53, Isaiah 7:14, Isaiah 9:6, Psalm 22, Micah 5:2, Genesis 49:10, and Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 through 27. Badawi is employing an apologetic dodge in this case. Since Jesus was well-loved, Psalm 69 could not refer to him. Jesus being well-loved by his followers does not contradict the fact that he was also intensely hated by many others. Psalm 69:4 reads, quote, "They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of mine head. They that would destroy me, being mine enemies, are mighty," end quote. A cursory reading of the gospel accounts shows that when Jesus was turned over to Pontius Pilate, the vast majority of people were yelling for the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. How Badawi can use verse 4 to argue against the gospel accounts is not only out of context, but insulting. Badawi argues against Matthew's account in chapter 27, verses 3 through 10. When Matthew presents the prophetic prediction about Judas in the Old Testament, he was actually quoting from Jeremiah 32, verses 6 through 9, and Zechariah chapter 11, verses 12 through 13. Jeremiah also mentions a potter's field in Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 2, Jeremiah 19, verses 2 and 11, of which Matthew is not bringing an exact quote from any of these. Matthew is simply quoting the more popular of the prophets, which was a common practice in that day. Matthew did the same thing earlier in Matthew chapter 5, verse 2, where he quoted from Micah chapter 5 verse 2 and Samuel chapter 5 verse 2. Obviously, it is Badawi who is mistaken and cannot be trusted. The Bible, written to stand all time, basically, because it is the Word of God, has the facts and evidence. As you dig into it, it always works out. I've been a Christian for over 20 years, and I'm used to people attacking the Scripture and saying it's wrong, and they give me all kinds of reasons and whatnot. I'm used to that. But if they could really prove to me that this Bible is a bunch of trash and garbage like they say it is, I would have given this Christian faith up a long time ago. I wouldn't be bothering with this stuff. Man, I'll do like Paul said. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, if your faith is vain, we of all men are most miserable. Why should I be miserable believing a bunch of garbage that's not true? You know, I'd give up the Christian faith and go live it up somewhere. But I am convinced, especially 20 years into this, that the Bible stands and the evidence is there. The God has provided more evidence than you could ever imagine for the truth and the validity of the Scripture. And I'm just giving you my personal testimony to that fact. It will stand a test, and no matter how many critics and unbelievers try to come against it, they just can't overwhelm something called the truth. And a lie never stands before a truth, and God's Word is the truth. And as we go through this series, we'll see why Badawi's arguments continue to crumble time and time again. Well, I've kind of hogged the screen here. Let me get my brother Steve in on some of this. Go ahead, Steve. Anything you want to talk about?
Yeah, there is kind of a curious thing about many of the New Testament prophecies of the Old Testament. Some of them were paraphrased, like Larry says, but some of them, they seem more closer to the Septuagint than they did to the Masoretic text of the Old Testament. Now, one reason might be, you know, many Jews were Greek-speaking Jews and used the Septuagint. But since that time, they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. And in some of the passages in question, the Dead Sea Scrolls support the same reading of the New Testament versus the Masoretic text. Not all the time, but some of the time. So it's sort of like the things that at first seemed like there were small variants actually are more supporting, since we found the Dead Sea Scrolls from before the time
of
Christ.
That's right. So, any other arguments there that you see Badawi made that you might want to talk about?
I think you covered it pretty well. You know, Badawi just kind of makes these declarations. Oh, this didn't refer to Jesus because Jesus was well-liked. Okay, well, yes, Jesus was loved by some. But that doesn't negate the fact that he also had lots of enemies, too. You know, it's not an either-or thing.
That's right. That's out of Psalm 69:4. Right. And to make that argument to me is, you know, obviously, it hit me as being totally ludicrous.
He's reaching. Maybe he's just trying to get the best ones he could, and that's the best he could find. I don't know.
You know, when you're grasping at straws, sometimes even the straws you're grasping at aren't too good. They don't work out too well. But the arguments he's making here from these prophecies and things really don't work, because he's trying to take the New Testament writer is quoting from a special verse in a psalm or something from the Old Testament. He's quoting a specific verse or passage. And what Badawi tries to do to discredit that is take the whole chapter or several chapters, but mainly just the whole chapter that verse or passage is being quoted from, and then try to take something in that passage that the New Testament writer was not referring to. He was not referring to these other passages, parts of the passage. He was referring to this specific passage as the prophecy. But then Badawi tries to take something that's unrelated somewhere else in the passage and say that ties in with this prophetic utterance that the New Testament writer is arguing from. And he's basically just putting words in the New Testament writer's mouth when he does that, because he's not accepting what the passage itself says. He says, oh, well, that might work if I just take that, but I'm not going to just take that. I'm going to go somewhere else that the New Testament writer is not referring to and try to bring that into it so I can discredit it. And I don't think that's really an honest way to approach something,
right?
By just taking something else and going that route. Take number 7, crucifixion 4 and 5. A, Badawi says Matthew is obsessed with prophecies, and of course he said that in the last tape too. Point B, Badawi tries to dismiss many prophecies about Jesus in the Old Testament as not true. C, Badawi talks about how Muhammad is prophesied in the Bible.
Jesus himself taught them these Old Testament prophecies and said, you're witnesses of this. And so he commanded his disciples to be witnesses of that. And today, we are witnesses of that, and Muslims are not.
That's right. That's right. And I also like to mention, I mentioned this in other shows, but there's many good Christian books out there available on prophecy. This is just one I just happened to pick up. But behind us, we have Josh McDowell's book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. And, you know, there's a new updated version. There's many good Christian apologetic works out there that show you all these Bible prophecies, list them out, show you the supernatural case for the Bible and for Jesus. So, you know, when you see this, check out your Christian bookstore or get it with a Christian book publisher and get your hands on some of this material that shows you all these Bible references that Battley is having such a hard time dealing with. So just wanted to get that plug in. Now let's go to Battley's idea of Bible prophecy. I have his tract right here. You can see it on the screen. This is just a Xerox copy of it. It's coming from the Islamic Teaching Center. But it's called Muhammad in the Bible by Dr. Jamal Battley. And in here, Battley gives a synopsis of how the Bible prophesized Muhammad. Now, I want to analyze this in detail and see if Dr. Battley really understands Bible prophecy. I mean, he seems to know how all the guys that wrote the Bible don't know anything about prophecy and they're all wrong. But let's see if Dr. Battley is right when he talks about Bible prophecy and how the Bible predicts Muhammad.
Muhammad is prophesied in the Bible? Muslims quote the Quran, Surah 11:17, which talks of Moses. Then go to Deuteronomy 18:18, which says, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. Muhammad could never be the one spoken of here, because he is not of the Israelite, quote, brothers, or, quote, countrymen, as found in some translations. Muhammad was an Arab from Saudi Arabia. See also Judges 20, verse 13, and Deuteronomy 17:15. The prophet Moses spoke, quote, face to face, end quote, Exodus 33:11, with God, as did Jesus, but Muhammad never did. Additionally, Muhammad cannot be the Deuteronomy 18:18 prophet because Muslims claim that Muhammad came from the line of Ishmael and not Isaac. Deuteronomy 17:21 makes it clear that God's covenant is with Isaac, not Ishmael. The Muslim translator, A. Yusuf Ali, is so concerned about this that he even mistranslates his own English translation of the Quran in Surah 29, verse 27, to sneak, so to speak, Muhammad in by way of Abraham, who is not found in the original Arabic text of Surah 29, 27. I guess Yusuf Ali felt like Muhammad and the angel Gabriel had missed a big point in the Quran, so Ali decided to help them out. Since Muhammad preached a different God than Moses and Jesus, Muhammad was simply a candidate for being stoned to death by violating Moses' commands in Deuteronomy 18, 9-14 and Deuteronomy chapter 13, 6-11, Acts 3:19-23, written by Luke, says that prophet is Jesus, not Muhammad, in Deuteronomy 18:18. Once again, Battley is calling the New Testament writers liars.
So from the biblical record and from the historical evidential record, you cannot get Muhammad out of this passage because he was not an Israelite.
Right.
And
Jesus was closer in time anyway, so you'd say, well, even if Muhammad wasn't Israelite, this would make more sense to be with Jesus, you know, speaking to the Jews, you know, than Muhammad in another spot.
Plus, we have the Bible itself in Luke, in Acts chapter 3, saying this prophecy is talking about Jesus. So we get it right from the gospel writers.
The Muslims also appeal to Surah 61:6, where Jesus supposedly prophesies, quote, praised one, end quote, quote, Ahmad, quote, for Muhammad, and then say Jesus' prediction that the paraclete, quote, helper, end quote, would come. That would be found in the New Testament, John 14, verses 16, 26, chapter 15, 26, and chapter 16, verse 7, is talking about Muhammad. The Muslims say the word there should be parakletos, or praised one, not paraclete. Parakletos has the same meaning as Ahmad to Muslims. Ahmad is the heavenly name of Muhammad. Muslims say Christians deviously changed Parakletos to paraclete to hide this prophecy of Muhammad. The Muslims are wrong, as the historical manuscript evidence predating Muhammad shows no such changes in the original text.
So in other words, if we have manuscripts in museums today, which we do, saying Parakletos from 100, 150 AD, and 200 AD and onward, then to say that that was changed by Christians after Muhammad came is a lie, and the tape should be edited and shouldn't say that anymore.
That's right. That's right. So we got a real problem here, because see, with the Muslims, it's always easy for them to say Paul didn't say that, or either Paul said it, but he was crazy and he didn't know what he was saying and he was just fooling around with people, or John didn't write John, Matthew didn't write Matthew. It's easy to just make those claims and say those things, or these Christians came along and changed the Greek there so they could get rid of the prophecy of Muhammad. But how would they know to do that? If this is hundreds of years before Muhammad, how would they even know that Muhammad was coming to even to deviously change the Greek text in the Bible?
Prophetically change?
Let's see. I think there's going to be a prophet named Muhammad coming in about 300 years from now. We better change this in the Bible right away. Okay, get an eraser. Anyone got one? Bring it over here. Anyway, let's go back to our chart. The Muslims are wrong, as the historical manuscript evidence predating Muhammad shows no such changes in the original texts, of which 5,366 Greek manuscripts exist. Early church father writings predating Muhammad confirmed the same facts. No changes were made in the Greek for, quote, comforter or, quote, helper, which in Greek is paraclete, speaking of the Holy Spirit, in John 14:16, etc. The Muslim argument is also refuted by the context the passages are found in the Bible. Jesus is comforting his disciples with these words as his death is impending. If Jesus is talking about Muhammad, how could the coming of an Arab, non-Jewish prophet to be born more than 500 years later in a foreign land comfort the disciples at that critical moment in time? Jesus said, quote, "You know him," end quote, that being the helper or comforter, in verse 17. But the apostles did not know Muhammad. Anyway, John 14, verses 16 through 17, shows the coming one is a spirit whom the world will not see. This spirit would remain with them forever, and as a spirit, he would be in the disciples, unlike any mortal man could be. The world would not know the coming one, but only those who believed and accepted him. This comforter, or helper, is identified as the Holy Spirit in John 14:26, and of course, Jesus promised that the Spirit would be coming in a very short time, which happened 10 days after Jesus' ascension. See Acts chapter 2. As usual, the Muslims ignore all of this. One other point here. The Bible makes it clear that the world needs no other prophet after Jesus, for he is our prophet, priest, and king. See Hebrews chapter 1, Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20, John chapter 20, verses 30 through 31, Revelation chapter 22, verses 18 and 19, to name just a few. Jude 3 says, quote, "Exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith, which was once delivered unto the saints."
No, this was once delivered unto the saints. And in Hebrews chapter 1, it says, God has spoken to us by in various and the sundry prophets and places, but in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, Hebrews chapter 1. So, Steve, I think the record is clear here that Muhammad being prophesied in the Bible, and we covered the verses they use. Mm-hmm. We covered the very verses that they use to argue Muhammad's prophesied in the Bible. We got Deuteronomy 18:18 in there. We got those references about the Comforter in John chapter 14:15-16. And I don't think Battle has a leg to stand on
in saying that Muhammad is in the Bible.
What I think the conclusion is that the comforter in John, or counselor in John 14, is the same one as the counselor in John 16 and other places in John. And if he glorifies Jesus, then the conclusion is, let's do what the counselor says. Let's glorify Jesus together.
Amen. What I liked is, you know, they ignore context in those scriptures there where they say this is talking about Muhammad. It talks about, you know, one that the world would not see. But right. I think all these Muslims have seen Muhammad, but because he was just a man. And how is he going to get inside the disciples?
Mm-hmm.
You know, he hadn't even been born yet, and he's off in some other country. So they ignore all that context, and they just expect you to believe what they say about that one little phrase there. And they bring up this other stuff. But I will admit one thing for Dr. Badawi's benefit about Muhammad being in the Bible. Muhammad is in the Bible. Because every time you see a reference in the Old Testament or the New Testament where it talks about false prophets, that's Muhammad. And he's in the Bible. And the Bible talks about him. Every time you see a mention of a false prophet, that's talking about Muhammad. See, Badawi fails to tell his listeners and viewers the following. One, the Old Testament predicted that Christ would die. Isaiah 53, 5 through 10. Psalm 22:16, Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, Zechariah 12, verse 10. And Jesus fulfilled all of Old Testament prophecies about the Messiah. And you can see on your screen there, Matthew chapter 4, verses 14 through 16, Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 and 18, Matthew chapter 8, verse 17, John chapter 4, verses 25 and 26, and John chapter 5, verse 39. See, one reason Badawi has to attack all this so much is because the evidence is so strong. Now, point two here, Jesus predicted and openly announced his coming death many times. Look in John chapter 2, verses 19 through 21, John chapter 10, verses 10 through 11, Matthew chapter 12, verses 40, Mark chapter 8, verse 31, Matthew chapter 17, verses 22 and 23. Three, all of the predictions of his resurrection, both in the Old Testament, check out Psalm 16:10, Isaiah 26:19, Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. And in the New Testament, check out John chapter 2, verses 19 and 21, Matthew 12:40, Matthew chapter 17, 22, 23, are all based on the fact that Jesus, that's talking about he, would die. Only someone who dies can be resurrected.
Who is obsessed with prophecies? Matthew does in fact quote many prophecies about Jesus, and none about Muhammad, since there are none. However, Badawi's obsession with biblical prophecy shows his great concern for the strong evidence that biblical prophecy presents for the Christian message. If Christianity stands, and the biblical prophecies are true, then Islam falls. In desperation, because of the power of biblical prophecy, Badawi vainly attempts to include Muhammad in prophecy.
Well, I'm Larry Wessels with Steve Morrison for Christian Answers. Be with us next time as we cover this subject. Remember, all these scriptures in the Bible are testifying to the Jesus being the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the one we can put our trust in to be saved and reconciled to God. This is what the Bible says. This is what the Muslims are denying. But we're saying check out these facts, either pro or con, and I think you'll be convinced that the biblical record is true. Jesus is who he said he was, and he is worthy of your trust and devotion. With that, thank you for joining us. Be with us again next time. Thank you. God bless.